Hello and good day to everyone. So for today's video, I'm going to talk about a lesson on the Lit 2 Global Currents in World Literature. So specifically, I'm going to talk about Super Frog Saves Tokyo, a literary piece by Haruki Murakami. So of course, we must know the objective why we are studying this one. So explore subtle ways how Murakami's mysterious and emotionally prismatic narrative unfold environmental issues. Okay, so actually, I'm just going to read this one. But one of the advantages of this reading to this to you is that you could do something else while you are reading this one. Okay, so it's sort of like multitasking. So let's have the main characters. So the main characters, we have Katagiri. Okay, so this is a Japanese literary piece, by the way. Okay, so translated into English, of course. So we have Katagiri as the collections officer for the Tokyo Security Trust Bank and protagonist of the story. Katagiri is short, balding, and seemingly unremarkable. Nevertheless, Katagiri is a tough, reliable man, and Frog chooses him for the battle with Worm because he sees a courage and staunchness in the man whom everyone else seems to overlook. So later on, you're going to know the story why he was described as that one. So Frog, okay, that's the name actually, Frog, okay. It's a giant talking frog. Frog enlists Katagiri to help him battle Worm to save Tokyo from a giant earthquake. Frog has a deeply philosophical temperament, both in the sense that he enjoys knotty philosophical puzzles and that he is thoughtful, careful, and articulate. Even though Frog takes pains to prove that he's an actual frog, it remains unclear whether he truly exists. Later on, you're going to see why we are talking about whether he truly exists. So we have the supporting characters. So we have four. First one is Worm. Yes, the name itself is Worm. So he's a giant worm that slumbers deep beneath Tokyo City, directly under the offices of Katagiri's bank. Worm absorbs vibrations from the city, which slowly build up in his body until they are transformed into pure rage. When the rage reaches a critical point, Worm releases that energy in the form of devastating earthquakes. So we have the next one, the nurse. Okay, so the nurse played her role at the end of this literary piece. So she's a woman who tends Katagiri in the hospital after he is found passed out in the street. She is patient and motherly and treats Katagiri with great sympathy. So we have the young man, the man who shoots Katagiri shortly before he is supposed to battle Worm. Because Katagiri shows no signs of having been wounded, it seems likely that the young man is a figment of Katagiri's imagination. Next is Shirouka, an attorney for Big Bear Trading, a company that had been defaulting on loan payments to Katagiri's bank. After Frog pays a mysterious visit to the company leaders, Shirouka is dispatched to tell Katagiri that Big Bear will pay its debt as long as Frog is kept away. Later on, you will see why it happened that way. So we're going to have the summary, and for this summary, you're going to really know what happened in the story. So let's start. On February 15, 1995, Katagiri, a longtime collections officer for the Tokyo Security Trust Bank, is surprised to find a giant frog waiting for him politely outside his apartment. Frog introduces himself and apologizes for barging into Katagiri's home, claiming to have an urgent matter to discuss. He has come because Tokyo is about to be destroyed. Katagiri thinks that it must be a prank, but Frog assures him that they are the only ones present. Frog tells him that he isn't crazy and that Katagiri isn't dreaming. Confused and overwhelmed, Katagiri asks whether Frog is a real frog. Frog replies in the affirmative and demonstrates his realness by tilting back his head and letting out a wall-rattling series of ribbits. Ribbit, ribbit. Frog tells Katagiri that there will be an earthquake 3 days from now, much bigger than the one that struck Kobe a month earlier. More than 150,000 people will die, and the city's infrastructure will be destroyed. The epicenter will be right under Katagiri's bank office. So that's why Katagiri was chosen. Frog tells Katagiri that to stop the earthquake from happening, the two of them must go underground and do mortal combat with Worm. Frog explains that Worm is a giant worm that has slept deep beneath Tokyo for decades, his eyes and brain slowly atrophying. Worm absorbs reverberations as he sleeps and replaces those impulses with rage through a mysterious chemical process. When the rage builds to a certain level, he releases it in the form of an earthquake. Frog says that he feels no personal animosity toward Worm, but that Worm has nevertheless become too dangerous to ignore. Katagiri accepts this explanation, but he still doesn't understand why Frog has chosen him for the mission. Frog says that he's been watching Katagiri for a long time. He's seen Katagiri do the dirty, difficult work of collecting money from thugs without ever receiving the recognition he deserves. He's also seen the sacrifice Katagiri made for his siblings. Frog says there is no one in Tokyo he would rather have by his side in this battle. Katagiri suggests that Frog will be better off with someone who's stronger, maybe a martial arts expert. Frog waves him off, saying that he'll do the fighting but needs Katagiri for moral support. Frog is also frightened and reluctant to fight Worm, but he goes Nietzsche's maxim that the highest wisdom is to have no fear. As a final reassurance, Frog offers to solve a sticky loan situation for Katagiri involving a company called Big Bear Trading. Then Frog flattens himself and sleeps out through the door crack. The next morning, a lawyer calls Katagiri to say that the Big Bear will pay off all debts as long as Frog stays away. Frog comes to Katagiri's office at lunch. He tells Katagiri not to worry because no one else can see him. Now that he's proven his existence, Frog wants confirmation that Katagiri will help him fight Worm. There will be no glory in their battle, he warns, because no one besides the two of them will ever know that it has taken place. Katagiri tries to convince Frog once again that he's not worthy. But Frog says that people like Katagiri are the reason why Tokyo is worth saving and that only someone like Katagiri could help him win the battle. Katagiri reluctantly agrees. Frog describes how the two of them will head underground through a hidden shaft in the bank's boiler room on February 17. He assures Katagiri that he has battle plans but refuses to divulge them when Katagiri asks for details. Katagiri pushes again, asking what Frog will do if Katagiri gets scared and runs away. Frog thinks and then answers that he would just have to fight alone. Even though he would have about as much hope of defeating Worm alone as Anna Karenina would have had of beating the speeding locomotive that killed her. Frog seems disappointed that Katagiri has not read Tolstoy's novel. On the evening of the battle, however, Katagiri is shot while returning from his collection rounds. A young man in a leather jacket jumps in front of him and puts a slug in his right shoulder. Other shots follow. Katagiri wakes up in a hospital where the attending nurse explains that it's 9:15 a.m. February 18. Katagiri asks about the previous night's earthquake and is relieved to discover that nothing happened. He's perplexed, however, to learn that he wasn't shot. He was found lying unconscious on the street and had apparently been yelling Frog's name in the hospital all night long. Frog appears in Katagiri's hospital room that night, exhausted and wounded. Katagiri begins to apologize for not meeting him in the boiler room, but Frog explains that Katagiri did help him in his dreams. The battle took place in the area of imagination, Frog explains. He describes how Katagiri brought in a food-powdered generator to light Frog's way in the battle to fight off the encroaching darkness. In the end, Frog was unable to defeat Worm, able only to call a jaw and prevent the earthquake from taking place. Frog then slips into a coma. He begins to twitch and boils break out all over his body. The boils pop and creatures that look like worms, maggots, and centipedes start calling out. Frog's eyeballs fall to the floor where they are eaten by bugs. The entire room is covered with insects, blotting out the light, overwhelming Katagiri in his bed. He screams. The nurse turns on the light and the bugs are suddenly gone. She gives Katagiri an injection and tells him that he had another nightmare. Delirious, Katagiri tells the nurse that Frog sacrificed himself to save Tokyo from an earthquake. The nurse says that Katagiri must have been very fond of Frog. Locomotive, he says, more than anybody. She wipes the sweat from his brow as he drifts into a deep sleep. Okay, so let's have the theme of that literary piece, okay? So magical realism. Actually, this part will already discuss and explain why and how the story happened that way. So magical realism. Magical realism is a genre of literature that takes place that fantastical or surreal elements in a recognizably ordinary setting. Sometimes, these disparate elements sit comfortably alongside one another, and characters accept fanciful or supernatural occurrences as a part of everybody or everyday's life. In Super Frog Saves Tokyo, for example, the pitiable bank officer Katagiri spends most of the story wondering whether he can believe his eyes and his senses, which seem to tell him that a giant frog is talking to him and seeking his help in a battle against a giant worm. Katagiri's ordinariness and the relative poorness of his social and emotional life make the distinction between his previous life and the magical experience he shares with Frog even more pronounced. In Super Frog Saves Tokyo, the magic serves a healing purpose. If we choose to accept Frog's claims at face value that Tokyo is indeed being threatened with imminent destruction, then magic, as embodied by Frog, has come as a savior to heal the city's psychic damage by destroying Worm. But even if we don't believe the surreal premise and assume that Katagiri has imagined or hallucinated Frog, then we can still say that magic has healed him, even if the magic only lives in Katagiri's mind. Katagiri is a solitary, friendless man with no real connection to the world he lives in. When Frog comes to him, telling him that he has secretly been selected for a gloriously dangerous task, Katagiri's life gains a sense of meaning. Everything he has done thus far in his life has prepared him for this moment. None of his efforts were wasted or unappreciated. Perhaps more important, Katagiri has gained a true friend in the surreal monstrous frog, someone he is drawn to, cares for, and respects. The deep satisfaction Katagiri feels at the end of the story suggests that something inside him has indeed been healed by his extraordinary encounter. Okay, so of course, we need to target the objective for this literary piece. So, we need to identify the environmental issue which was implicitly given by Haruki Murakami, the author. So, of course, we need to identify the environmental issues. Okay, so one, of course, the very identifiable one is earthquake. And then another, okay, so implicitly, it's the nature of the world, full of inevitable disasters that harm the environment, and worse, the people living on Earth, okay? So, that one, of course, this is my reference, okay? That's why I told you that I am a little bit reading for this one, okay? So, for the activity in this section of your subject, you must answer the question and just comment down below your answer. So you need to answer this question: what do you think are the environmental issues needed to be addressed this year, and how do you think you could be of help to this? So that's all for this video. Thank you for listening. Bye.